الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، عليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. Today is the day of Arafah, and I honestly think that it's moments like this, coincidences like this, is truly, truly a sign and a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here we are, we started a series called Spiritual Growth a couple of weeks ago. And every day I've been trying to do my best to be with you and to encourage you and myself, inspire one another about something beautiful about our religion, al-Islam. And subhanallah, I wake up this morning and I start to think that, okay, I start putting my thoughts together about our subject today, which was about time. And lo and behold, it's also the day of Arafah. And time with the day of Arafah, they go hand in hand. How so? We have this one day of the entire year where so many special things happen. So despite that Hajj looks a little different this year, the point here is that Hajj is still happening. And there are still hundreds of people that are performing their Hajj at this very moment and that are standing in the plains of Arafah. And so even if you had an intention to go for Hajj, but because of COVID or any other reason, you can't make it, one of the things that this day, the day of Arafah, helps us to realize is that we should also and always be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all the things that we do have, and also be happy and proud for the pilgrims that are there, that did get the opportunity to go. And I am sure, inshaAllah ta'ala, there are many pilgrims that are standing in the plains of Arafah, and guess what they're doing? They are making dua for you and me. They are making dua for the entire ummah. And so I know that, okay, physically I might not be there, but there has to be, inshaAllah, and I'm sure just our common sense would teach us this, that inshaAllah ta'ala, hundreds of those pilgrims will be praying for us, will be saying, oh Allah, bless the ummah, oh Allah, protect the ummah, oh Allah, give them knowledge, wisdom, guide them to the straight path. All of these different types of dua that we make collectively for one another, I'm sure that those duas are now being made. And inshaAllah ta'ala, as our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam taught us, that it's on this day that when you make dua and you're a pilgrim standing in the plains of Arafah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends and comes closer to His believers and responds to their du'as, accepts their praise, accepts the efforts of these pilgrims. And so that we don't be left out and we don't feel like we're being left out on that experience, we have the opportunity to do something similar. We get to recognize and celebrate the day of Arafah by fasting, by praying, by doing all of the wonderful things that you have been preoccupied with since these first days of Dhul-Hijjah began. Now, with that being said, keep in mind also, and this is a hadith that we've mentioned in the past in some of our previous episodes, that once you have a good intention, our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told us in an authentic hadith in Bukhari, that when a believer makes an intention to do a righteous deed and they're not able to follow through and perform that righteous deed, because of their sound intention, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them the reward as though they performed that righteous deed. So today is a great opportunity that anything that you say and do, really, really do it in the most sincere way possible and really take the time to improve yourself. So do some of the simple things, recite a little bit of Quran today, do a little bit of extra adhkar, and keep in mind that after each of the fard prayers, our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam would recite the takbirat. So he would recite, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, walillahi alhamd. And he would say that sentence three times after every fard prayer. And this will go on until the 13th day of Dhul-Hijjah. For me, I mean, considering what your time zones are, for me, that will correspond to Monday coming, inshaAllah ta'ala. So try to do these little things because it really helps you to stay connected not only with your Creator, but it kind of makes you feel like you're somewhat connected to those pilgrims who are standing in the plains of Arafah. The next point here is with time. We have one day. Our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told us that this day, the day of Arafah, is the best and most beloved day of the entire year to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so with that being said, time is a factor now in the sense that it's prioritized now today to take advantage of all the blessings that we have for this particular day that are increased, the rewards, the forgiveness. Really do your best to take advantage of it. Why? Because we don't know if we will be blessed with the time again in the future to experience such a day. As we've all seen, this year, 2020, from since the first day of January until now, just think of all the crazy things that have happened around the world, all the disasters, all of the tragedies, all of the pain and suffering at all levels. So whether it be at a global level, whether it be to do with the environment, whether it to do with on a political scale, whether it, now we have the COVID, we were in this pandemic, so many things just continue to unfold. And our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam did teach us that once these types of fitna continue to increase, so more disasters, more natural disasters, more fitna, once these things continue to increase, then realize that the sa'ah, the day of judgment, is near. So all of these things are not just happening because the world is just getting out of control, but it's also part of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's plan that the day of judgment is coming and it's getting nearer and closer to us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us strength. Allahumma ameen. So time and this blessed day of Arafah, they go hand in hand. Another point to just keep in mind is today is also a day where you and I take the time to pray for others as well, but we also start to reflect on some of the things that we want to change about ourselves. You know yourself better than anyone else after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody can come and say to you, okay, this is your problem or this is what you need to do. It's important that people give you some feedback. If people want to be critical and tell you certain things that you need to improve, it's important that you at least listen to that, because good advice would always be helpful and always be fruitful for the believer. The believer is always open to sound nasiha and good advice. And what that should do for you and I as believers is it should at least allow us and stimulate some sense of reflection, that we ponder on ourselves and some of the things that we have to do to continue to improve. Again, you do this with the notion that time is running out. And with that being said, the only thing that I want to take you through is the one of the most beautiful and important surahs of the entire Quran. Whenever you talk about time, this is the surah that usually pops into the minds of believers when you think about this important concept. And this particular surah, it's a surah that we've all memorized since we were children. And I'm sure a lot of you, without even me saying it yet, you all know what surah I'm referring to. And that is, of course, Surah Al-Asr. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. This particular surah, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah once said that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down this surah and this surah alone, it would be sufficient for all of us. Because in this surah, it has all of the steps and details and knowledge and things that you and I need to live a successful and happy and content life in this world, as well as being able to be candidates of those that will reap the rewards and blessings in the hereafter. Let's go through the surah really quickly. It starts off with wal asr. Asr comes from the word asirun, and asirun means freshly squeezed juice. So I want you to just imagine for a moment that if you have like a citrus fruit, like lemon or orange or something, and you just squeeze that fruit, squeeze the orange, and all the droplets that fall from that orange, that is a reflection of our entire life. So the next time you have an orange, or you see, you peel a lemon, or you have something, and you start to see the juices and the droplets of those juices, now instead of them just being food or something to quench your thirst, you know what they become? That lemon, that orange, becomes like a khutbah to you. It's talking to you now. It's reminding you of your entire life. It starts to become like a dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is how you trained your mind to focus that everything you see and experience in your life, you can relate it back to the Quran or some hadith that you know. And that takes time. But what a beautiful state to be in, that even a fruit can remind you and connect you with your Creator and increase your iman. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us. So first ayah here, wal asr, Allah azza wa jal gives an oath by time. So it's as if Allah is saying, I swear by al asr. Al asr is one of the names of in the Quran that refers to time. Time is a concept that you and I, as human beings, we will never truly understand how time works. We will never truly understand that in this part of the world, people are waking up. In another part of the world, people are going to sleep. In another part of the world, people are in the middle of their nights. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that in the middle of the night, He descends to the last heaven and comes closest to their servants, to His servants that are praying and seeking His blessing and reward. But at the same time, where another part of the world, it's daytime, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not descending. Like, we'll never understand how this stuff works. And so time is something that is truly remarkable in the sense that the only knowledge that we have is that time is the greatest asset that we have, but it's also the greatest loss that we suffer from. We can't reverse it, we can't change it, we can't do anything. And subhanAllah, that alone tells us just how important time truly is in our lives, in our personal lives, in everything that we say and we do. So we pray that Allah Azza wa Jalla puts barakah in our time, which leads me to the next point. One of the du'as our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam used to make to Allah Azza wa Jalla is for Allah to put barakah in his time. So pray on this day that Allah blesses your time. The next ayah, innal insana lafi khusr, indeed, people, human beings, mankind, they are at a loss. And the word that is used here is khusr. Now, there are three forms of this word that's common in the Quran. You have khusr, you have khusran, and you have khasirun, and different forms of that same word as well, right? The point here is very simple. Khusr is the bare minimum version of loss. If you say khusran, you'll lose a big portion, but khusr is the bare minimum. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that the greatest loss that mankind suffers from is that even if they lose a second and a minute of their day and they've wasted it without reflecting or thinking or utilizing their time well, that is the thing that mankind is at a loss. So what is the loss that Allah is referring to in this ayah? It's not the loss of prayer and barakah and blessings. Sure, those things do happen as well. But the loss that Allah is emphasizing in is the loss of time. That's our greatest asset. That's the most important thing to all of us. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. So now four things are going to be mentioned. Except for the ones who have iman. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Now here's the thing. You and I, we have iman. Alhamdulillah. The Sahabas, when they got this surah, many of them had already converted to Islam. They believed in Allah and they had iman. They had iman with the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. So how do you and I relate to something that we already have? Again, go back to the beginning of the surah. It's all about time. As long as you are alive, you do your best to preserve your faith, but also with the understanding and the realization that you could potentially lose your faith if you don't take time seriously. It could lead you that you become careless about decisions, about choices, and about life at large. And as a result, that faith that you took for granted, that you thought was going to be permanent, over and through time, you end up losing some of that faith. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that, because we want to live and die with our iman, insha'Allah ta'ala. So Allah azza wa jal says, okay, the four exceptions to the believers when it comes to utilizing their time is if you have iman, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. So again, you can't just talk the talk, you have to walk the walk. You have to live the life. You have to live a life that reflects iman in you. So I think that's very obvious, and we've talked about this in previous episodes as well. So the point is your life should reflect how important time is for you. And time is connected to your iman. So just think about it for a second. It's really just an absolutely beautiful surah of what it's trying to teach us. That when you take time seriously, that is a reflection of your iman. And how do you take time seriously? You live the life. Your actions reflect that you're always on time for things. When it's time for salah, you pray your salah on time. And it doesn't matter where you are. You're going to stop and you're going to pray. If you can't do that, then at least at some point in your 24-hour-a-day period, you will take time to read, to recite, to learn, to study, to pray, to do all of the things that that are required for us to do. So they work hand in hand. Then the third ingredient that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps us with so that we can take time seriously, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. Here's the third one, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ. And number four, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Tawasaw is the word that is used to describe counsel. So Allah Azza wa Jal is saying that for the believer, now that you take care of your iman and you also live a life that reflects that iman, and putting it all together in what sense? In the sense of you're taking your time seriously. That's you reflect that seriousness in righteous deeds. Then Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ. You also counsel with the truth. Counsel with the truth meaning that you also remind others about time. You teach this to your children. You remind each other, your families, your friends. If you go out for a coffee break, you don't sit and drink coffee for 4 hours. Because you're reflective of time and you encourage the people that you're sitting with, the people that you socialize with, that there's a limit to all of these things. And you know, at the end of the day, we have 24 hours in a single day. That's a lot of hours. If you really think about it, that's a lot of hours that we have. Put aside, give or take, 8 to 10 hours of sleep and rest. Then give or take a few more hours of eating, a couple more hours of just relaxing through the day. So let's just give or take that we have about maybe 10 hours or so where we could definitely do things beneficial in terms of uplifting our spirits and increasing our iman and knowledge. But you do this not just for yourself. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ. You also reflect and teach and counsel others with this truth that Allah blessed you with. And finally, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Nothing can be achieved in this world without patience. Nothing. Just think about anything that you strive for. You almost can never get it immediately. You have to wait at some point, whether it's a short time period or an extended time period. The point is there is patience that always revolves around the things that we need and we strive for in this world. You want to be a successful businessman? You got to wait. You got to work at that. It might take months. It might take years. You want to be a true believer that is counted and beloved and accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Then you've got to work at that every single day of your life. You want to help others? That also takes time for people to recognize and see, man, this person really does want to help us out, so that people can recognize. And you never know, when you're in need, they are there to help you now. Everything that we want to accomplish in this world takes time. But from a spiritual sense, religiously, how the Quran is talking about this concept of patience, we are the ummah of patience. Why? Because after us, there is no more prophet. There is no, there isn't another scripture. Nothing is left. The only thing that's left after us is the Day of Judgment. That's it. And speaking of which, how does Arafah look when all the pilgrims are standing and praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they're all dressed the exact same? It's almost as if it's a trailer. So it's like a trailer scene of the Day of Judgment. That's what the Arafah looks like when all those pilgrims are scattered and they're faced and they're standing, they're facing towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're looking up at the sky or they're facing towards the Qibla and they're just praying and praying and praying. It's almost as if it's like a rehearsal for the Day of Judgment. That's what Arafah is. And now the entire Ummah collectively, wherever you are, whether you're in Hajj or not, we're all together on the same path, thinking about the same thing, the blessings of this day. Many of us might be fasting, and even those who aren't fasting, the point is, this day means something to you and I. And so with that being said, we pray on this blessed day of Arafah, that inshallah ta'ala, Allah accepts from us our efforts. Forgive us of our sins, our shortcomings, our mistakes, our errors. May Allah Azza wa Jal forgive us of our weaknesses and turn them into strengths. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always continue to uplift us and make us the best believers that we can. Believers that He is proud of. Believers that He will accept and shower mercy and forgiveness upon, insha'Allah ta'ala. Allahumma ameen. I do want to conclude this slightly different from how we usually conclude our videos. And I just want to conclude it with dua. And so with that being said, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنًا وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنًا وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ اللهم إننا نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول أو عمل ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول أو عمل اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي فيها معادنا وأصلح لنا دنياي الذي فيها معاشنا. May Allah Azza wa Jal accept from us and purify the world that we live in a way that is pleasing to Him and pleasing for us. May Allah Azza wa Jal give us the strength and give us the barakah and the blessing that we live in happiness and contentment in the Akhirah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we just asked Him, we ask Allah Azza wa Jal, O Allah, we ask You for Your Jannah and anything that we say or do that leads us towards Your Jannah. وَنَعُوذُ بِكَ مِنَ النَّارِ وَمَا قَرَّبَ إِلَيْهَا مِنْ قَوْلٍ أَوْ عَمَلٍ. And when we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from the fire and anything that we say or do that leads us towards the fire, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to love and protect the pilgrims performing the Hajj. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from them their Hajj, bless them with a Hajj al-Mabroor, wa Sa'i al-Mashkoor, wa Dhanb al-Maghfoor, Allahumma Ameen. And to all of you, those of you listening, and even those of you who are not, for all of our brothers and sisters across the globe, may Allah Azza wa Jal keep you safe, keep you healthy, protect you, bless you, honor you and accept you. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khayran. Don't forget that tomorrow is Eid al-Adha. And insha'Allah ta'ala, very early in the morning, I will be on live. And guess what? You guys are gonna come with me as I go for my Eid prayers, insha'Allah. So as soon as I get in the car, you're gonna drive with me, insha'Allah. And hopefully, as long as everything is set up right, I'll try my best to record tomorrow's khutbah, insha'Allah ta'ala. Eid Mubarak, kullu amin wa antum bikhair, taqabbalallahu minna wa minkum. A blessed, wonderful, and beautiful Eid Mubarak to each and every one of you. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from us our righteous deeds. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khayran, everyone. I will see you again tomorrow bi-idhnillah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.